everyone, myself Neha Shah from LG Institute of Engineering and Technology from the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering. Today I am going to explain you the topic properties of Z-transform from the fourth unit, which is Z-transform from the subject of signal and systems. Up to last session I had explained you what is Z-transform, what is the basic use of Z-transform, then we have taken some standard signal and we have find the Z-transform of it along with its ROCs, right? Now in this session I will taking some different properties of the Z-transform. So if we are taking the properties of Z-transform, the first property is linearity property. Now what is linearity property? As we have taken the linear time invariant system, so we can apply the linearity property. Now what is linearity property? If any system follows the superposition principle, then it will consider as linear, right? So if you want to apply the linearity property, so what will be the linearity property? If we are taking the linear combination in the time domain, then corresponding to it in the Z domain also we can apply the linearity property. We can take the linear combination of the Z transform of the input sequences, right? So if we want to take any property of Z transform, so in the any properties of Z transform, first of all we will writing the statement of it, then we will proving the statement, right? So for that, first of all I am taking the statement for the linearity property, which is if we are taking two signals x1 of n and x2 of n, and if we are finding the Z transform of it, then it will give you the x1 of z and x2 of z respectively. So if we are taking this two terms, then what is the linearity property? A1 x1 of n plus a2 x2 of n, this will be convert in the Z format like a1 x1 of z plus a2 x2 of z. It means if we are taking the linear combination in the time domain, then corresponding in the Z domain also we can take the linear combination of these two things. Here we have taken the a1 and a2 as constant. So to prove any property of the Z transform, first of all we are starting with the equation of bilinear Z transform. So if we are starting proof, in this first of all I am taking the equation of bilinear Z transform, which is Z transform of x of n equals to x of z, and its value will be summation n equals to minus infinite to infinite x of n z is to minus n. Right. If I am finding the value of x of n Z transform, so over here I am taking x of n. Now we have to find out Z transform of this term. So instead of this x of n, we have to take a1 x1 of n plus a2 x2 of n. So if we want to find out Z transform of a1 x1 of n plus a2 x2 of n, so instead of this x of n, I will take this term. So the equation will be like this, summation n plus minus infinite to infinite a1 x1 of n plus a2 x2 of n into z raised to minus n, right? Now we have to apply the rule over here. This term will representing like suppose a plus b into c. So what will be the rule? A plus B into C, it means A into C plus B into C, right? And we'll apply this summation to both of this term. So in the next step, we'll taking Z transform of A1 X1 of N plus A2 X2 of N is equals to, this term will convert in this format, A1 is constant, so it will be outside of this summation. Summation N equals to minus infinite to infinite x1 of n into z raised to minus n plus a2 is constant, so it will be outside of this summation. Summation n equals to minus infinite to infinite x2 of n into z raised to minus n. Now as you know that what is the equation of Z transform? Equation of Z transform is summation n equals to minus infinite to infinite x of n z raised to minus n, right? So suppose if I am taking this term, it will representing as x of z. Similarly, here we have taken summation n equals to minus infinite to infinite x1 of n into z raised to minus n. It means this will representing as Z transform of x1 signal, right? So instead of this term, we will taking x1 of z. Similarly, instead of this term, we are taking the term as x2 of z. So what will be the final term? A1 into x1 of z plus a2 into x2 of z. So this is the linearity property. This way we can prove the property. Now if we are finding the ROC of this, what will be the ROC? Combined ROC is considered as intersection of ROC of x1 of z and ROC of X2 of Z. So it is considered as its final ROC. Now we are taking the next property, which is time shifting property. Now if you want to shift the signal in the time domain, what will be the notation? X of n minus something or x of n plus something, right? So if you want to shift the signal, then for that we have to take x of n minus a. Suppose if I am taking this, then what will be the z transform for this? So we have to write down first of all the statement for this, and then we have to prove this property. So if I am writing the statement for this, what will be the statement? If we are taking x of n and finding the z transform of this, then it will give you the answer as x of z. Then the value of time shifted signal is x of n minus k, then its z transform is zx2 minus k x of z, right? So how will you remember this term? X of n minus k, right? So because of x of n we are writing x of z, and because of this minus k we have to remember that zx2 minus k term will multiply with this x of z. This property is very important in solving some more advanced example or more complex example based on this. So you have to remember this statement for time shifting property. Now if you want to prove this property, then we'll starting with the bilateral z transform, which is z transform of x of n equals to x of z equals to summation n equals to minus infinite to infinite x of n z is to minus n, right? Now here instead of x of n we have to find out z transform of x of n minus k, right? So if I am finding z transform of x of n minus k, so instead of this x of n I will put x of n minus k. Here we have to apply the rule, as in this x of something which term will be there, instead of this we have to take any another variable, like we will taking the n minus k equals to n. So like we are taking n minus k equals to n, so this term will convert in the form of x of n. Now here we have to use n. So what will be the value of n? If we are simplifying this, then the value of n equals to n plus k. K goes over right side, so it will be considered as n equals to n plus k, right? Now what will be the range of n? Here we have taken the range of n equals to minus infinite. So if I am putting minus infinite in this equation, so minus infinite minus k equals to minus infinite. Minus infinite minus something, it will give you minus infinite, right? Similarly, if I am taking n equals to infinite, then infinite minus k means infinite minus something, it will give you the part as infinite. So the range of n will be minus infinite to infinite as it is, right? Now we are putting this all the values in the above equation. So the next step will be z transform of x of n minus k equals to, this term will convert in the form of x of n. The range of n will be minus infinite to infinite, and instead of n we will putting n plus k, right? So the term will be summation n equals to minus infinite to infinite x of n z is to minus n plus. Now if I am simplifying this term, as you know that if I am taking the value of z raised to a plus b, so what will be the solution for this? Z raised to a into z raised to b, right? So similarly we'll apply this rule over here. So the next step is z raised to minus m into z raised to minus b. So this term will convert in the form of summation m equals to minus infinite to infinite x of m as it is. This term will convert in the form of z raised to minus m into z raised to minus k. Now you can see that the summation is of n. So this z raised to minus k doesn't contain any term of the n, so it will consider as a constant with respect to this summation, right? So this term will go outside of this summation, so the term will be z raised to minus k summation n equals to minus infinite to infinite x of n into z raised to minus n. Here imagine that instead of n, if we are imaging n, then this term will consider as summation n equals to minus infinite to infinite x of n into z raised to minus n, which is the formula of bilateral z transform, right? So instead of this we can take x of z. So this term will convert in the form of x of z, it will multiply with z raised to minus k. So this is your final z transform of this time shifted signal. Now, if we're finding the ROC, ROC is same as x of z, but here the term z raised to minus k is included, right? So, because of this, if we're taking the value of k greater than 0, then it will consider as z raised to minus something, right? So, it means 1 upon z raised to something. In that, if I'm putting z equals to 0, so it will give you the infinite response. Similarly, if I'm taking k less than 0, then it will give you the term as z raised to k. In that, if I'm taking z equals to infinite, then also it will give you the infinite output, right? So, these two terms will not include in the ROC. So, the final value of ROC is same as x of z, except for z equals to 0, if we are taking the value of k greater than 0, and z equals to infinite if we are taking k less than 0. Now, the next property is scaling in the z domain. As you know that, what is the scaling property? If I am multiplying or dividing by any constant term, then it will consider as scaling property, right? As you know that x of 2t or x of t by 2, x of 3t or x of t by t, likewise, this all the kinds of terms will representing as scaling. But here we have to do the scaling in the z domain. So the terms will be like this, x of z divided by something or x of z multiplied by something. So what will be the statement for this? If we are taking the x of n and finding the z transform, then it will convert in the form of x of z, right? Now here we have to apply scaling property in the z domain. It means if I am multiplying or dividing this z with the help of any constant like a, then what will be the change in the time domain? So for that, suppose if I am taking x of z divided by a, then here in the time domain we have to multiply the input sequence x of n with the term a raised to n. So the statement will be like this, a raised to n, x of n, the z transform of it equals to x of z divided by a. It means scaling in this z domain. Okay. Now we have to prove this statement. So for that, first of all, I am starting with the equation of bilateral z transform, which is z transform of x of n equals to x of z equals to summation n equals to minus infinite to infinite x of n z is to minus n. Right. Here we have to find out z transform of this term. So instead of x of n, I am taking this term. So z transform of a raised to n x of n. So instead of this x of n, I will put this term as a raised to n x of n. Now I am simplifying this term. So what will be the next step? X of n goes over here and this term is a raised to n z raised to minus n, right? So I am merging this two term a raised to n and z raised to minus n. So the next step is summation n equals to minus infinite to infinite x of n, and this term will convert in this format a raised to minus 1 into z raised to minus n. Why we have convert this form? Because here we have to take z raised to minus n term, right? So this will be converted in that form, raised to minus n. So if I am taking raised to minus n, so minus n minus 1 will give you n term, and minus n into 1 means it will give you minus n, right? Now if I am taking z raised to minus n, so z raised to this, it means it will give you x of z. Similarly here, this term raised to minus n, so this term representing capital X of A inverse Z. So it will representing as capital X A inverse Z, and if we simplify this, then A inverse means 1 by A. So final answer is X of Z by A. So this way we can prove this property. Now if you want to find out the ROC for this, what will be the ROC? Suppose if I am taking the ROC of X of Z in between R1 to R2, then the ROC of this scaling property is, instead of z, we have taken z by a, right? Because scaling in the z domain. So instead of z, I am taking z by a, which will be in between R1 to R2. Now if I am simplifying this, a will multiply over here as well as here. So the final ROC is mod of a R1 to mod of a R2. So the value of mod z will be in between these two terms. So this way we can take any property of this z transform. For that we have to take this statement, then we have to prove that, and At last, we can find out ROC of the different Z transform by using the properties. Right. In the next session, I will explain some more properties of the Z transform. Thank you so much.